So just a quick heads up, there's a couple gruesome pictures in this video, and so if you're squeamish, we'll put a little warning on the screen. You might want to avert your eyes. This is a scary time. 6.6 million people filed for unemployment last week. Most of my friends are terrified and don't know if they're going to be able to pay rent next month, how they're going to feed themselves, and I know this is a common theme with a lot of people around the whole world, not just Americans. And I've never shared this story publicly, and I thought this might be a really good time to kind of talk about how I took a time in my life that was sort of a scary disaster and used it to sort of motivate myself to change my life and create discipline and goals, and how I sort of changed the way that I thought about things to help myself get better. And I think in this time of uncertainty and a lot of fear for people, it's a great time to be able to sort of use it to find ways to get to where you want to be. I know lots of people really feel that they may be stuck or in tough situations, but that's just never the case. You can always change your life. And I want to tell this story about how I changed mine. It was June 5th, 2010. I had just gotten off a bar shift. I had been home. I was out walking my dog. And I had these gang members that had moved across the street from me about 6 months prior. And as they moved in and started to become more comfortable in the neighborhood, they started to escalate their behavior. And, you know, it went from, you know, just being kind of rowdy to starting to harass anybody who wasn't Caucasian that was walking by, you know, hey, where are you from? And what are you doing over here on this side of town, kind of thing. And eventually, you know, I had heard incidents where they'd beat people up, that kind of thing. And I was getting towards my house. There's two streets that intersect each other. I lived on this street and they lived on the corner of one that dead end right into my street. And I walked up and there was about 8 to 10 of them. They had a couple surrounded. They had knives, bats, other weapons, and they were screaming at this couple. And this couple was pinned against their car. They were blocked from getting in their car. And I realized very quickly that they were in a bad situation and I needed to do something. I tied my dog to the fence. Actually, it was great. A neighbor of mine was walking home. She'd been out at the bars and grabbed my dog, thankfully, to keep her out of harm's way. But I took out my bartending flashlight, which is a military flashlight, Surefire, if anybody is familiar. And it's very, very bright, and it's used in self-defense, you know, to sort of diffuse situations because it's so bright. You know, if you shine it in someone's face, they can't see. So I shined it on them and yelled, "Santa Barbara police, freeze," which I was hoping in the moment would get them to run and give the couple a chance to get in their car. And it worked. They threw their weapons and they ran. That was actually what probably saved my life, the fact that they threw their weapons in that moment because they didn't have them later. But very quickly, they realized that I wasn't chasing them like a police officer would. And so very quickly, if anybody's been in a bad situation, you know that it goes, there's like a split second where it goes from okay to horrible. And it just happened. All of a sudden, it was me and 8 to 10 guys. And you know, the great thing about being in that situation is you don't have to aim your punches. You just kind of give it all you got. And I did all right for a little while. But eventually a cab driver tried to run him over and help me. Someone ended up getting behind me. I didn't see him, and they hit me in the back of the head with a bat or a 2x4. And knocked me unconscious. They dragged me up the street and kept kicking me until a police officer that was filling out a report about 2 blocks away kind of noticed something was wrong. Later, she said there was just too many people moving in the street. So she came flying up. I guess she scared him off. She didn't arrest anybody in that moment. I think three of the group ended up getting arrested later. And I remember waking up in a pool of blood that was so big that I thought I was dead. I remember lifting my head up a little bit and looking and saying, "I'm a ghost." And I remember how sad that was. And I looked up and there was this collective gasp from people that had sort of gathered. There was 9 police cars, an ambulance. I must've been out for a while, I don't know how long, but there was this collective gasp and I realized I was alive. And the joy in that moment was really special. And I still remember that feeling of like, oh my gosh, I'm alive. I went to the hospital, I ended up with a broken nose, a broken eye socket, 2 broken hands, a broken wrist. I had 40 staples in my head, 30 stitches in my face. It's why, if anybody have ever noticed in a video, I've got a big scar on my nose and this Harry Potter looking thing on my forehead. And It was brutal. They thought I broke my neck, so they put me in a neck brace, which was just brutal. Oh my gosh. When you're in pain and in a neck brace, it is just not fun. And again, the story is about the aftermath. And the next day, I was okay. I was hurt, but I mentally was okay. And, you know, it was a good story to tell. I grew up kind of in a tough kid, and I went to a tough high school. And, you know, we spent a lot of times as kids kind of scrapping and being rowdy. And so I felt like it was a fun story to tell, and I'd heal, and I was okay. In fact, this picture, you could see it made national news, and this picture was on CNN. And granted, I was much younger, but that is my bong in the background, and that was on national news. So that was kind of funny. I didn't realize that when the reporter asked me to take this picture. But 3 weeks later, a local liquor store owner three blocks over from me was killed by three guys who were drunk, and he wouldn't sell them beer, and they beat him up and killed him. And something snapped in me. I had never been unable to control my emotions, or at least get a handle on them. But suddenly, being around large groups of people would cause me to shake uncontrollably. I would start sweating profusely. Just walking down the street, if there was like a group of four guys walking towards me, I would start to physically lose it. And it was awful. I'd never experienced anything like it. And luckily in California, we have this thing called the Victim Restitution Fund. And they paid for all my medical bills, and the people who are convicted of the crime have to pay that money back before they're released from probation. And so it paid for therapy, and I'd never done therapy before, and it ended up being an incredible thing for me. In fact, I didn't do it for very long because I really very quickly learned some things that I still carry with me today, which is when something terrible happens, it can do one of three things to you. It can define you, destroy you, or give you strength. And I decided really quickly I was gonna derive strength from this. And it's sort of when I developed a mantra that can best be defined as no zero days. And it's kind of the lesson that I want to impart on you is, you know, this is a really scary, tough time. And what you can do now is use this time, if you're laid off or if you lost your job, you're at home, is decide what you want to do, what you want to make your no zero days about. And what no zero days is, it's about defining your goals, short and long term. And you can do that through a list or, you know, a mental checklist if you're the type of person, whatever kind of organization you like, and do something towards those goals every day. Whether that's small, you know, and you're tired and you've been sitting around all day, you know, the last 15 minutes of the day, if your goal is to get in better shape, do some push-ups, do some sit-ups before you go to bed. Or if it's you want to create a content creation business or a woodworking business where you want to sell your furniture, you know, go work on your website or your social media, or take a Skillshare class and learn something about what it is that you want to change your life to. And, you know, if you look at this, they say there's only one way to eat an elephant, and that's one bite at a time. This happened to me now 10 years ago. It'll be 10 years in June. And I look at my life back then. I was in construction. I had a construction company. We were doing pretty good. I had 30 to 50 employees, depending on the season. And I just hated it. I hated it. At the end of a construction project, everybody's angry. It took too long. It cost too much. And I hated that part of my job. And I knew that I wanted to make things, and I knew that I wanted people to be happy with what I built. And I'd never made furniture before, but I started to get into it a little bit, and I decided, you know what? I'm never gonna do something that doesn't make me happy for the rest of my life. And so I decided that I wanted to make furniture, and I decided that I wanted to take steps towards that. So a little bit at a time, I started to develop my plan. I would do a little something every day towards making that a reality. And eventually I just walked away from my construction company. I gave it to my partner. You know, I had no income, I had very little money saved, and I just said, you know what, it doesn't matter. I'm gonna be hungry, I'm gonna make this work. And so I got into it, and I used to be in this little shed with no power. I had to run extension cords to it. And I started learning, and I started growing my craft, and, you know, I started to sell little tea light holders, boxes. And then, you know, I developed the Cat's Moses dovetail jig and started to work on making that a product. And I just did a little bit at a time. And here we are 10 years later. And, you know, my life professionally is awesome. Last couple of years have been kind of tough for me. emotionally, I've been going through a divorce, but with this mantra, I've been able to just keep, even though I have tough days, I've been able to keep my sights on the goals. And I change my goals all the time. I update them, I add to them. And every day I pull out my list and I look at it and I say, look, let's do something to get towards. I know you're having a tough day. I know emotionally you've had a rough go of it today, but we're gonna pull out the list and we're gonna do something before we go to bed. And that's what I want for you guys. I want you to use this time of uncertainty and fear to identify your goals and grow yourself. And I think if you really just say, even if it's a little thing, I know it's hard because motivation, you know, maybe after watching this video, you're motivated, but motivated is a short-term thing. Discipline is a long-term skill. And when you just attack a little bit every day, eventually you wake up one day and it's a habit, and that's discipline. And so I think if you can just know 0 days yourself, eventually at some point in time, whether it's 1 year, 2 years, 5 years, 10 years, you're gonna be where you wanna be. And if we take anything from this complete disaster that's happening to the whole world, it's that starting over is a great thing and being hungry is a great thing. So guys, I wish you the best in these uncertain times, and I'm here for you, whatever you need. I'm an email away. I'm happy to do whatever I can. So thank you so much for your support of this channel. We're working every day and still getting products out, and it's been an amazing thing that I am so blessed to be able to do. And it's because of you guys. So thank you so much for your support of the channel and all the kind words that I get on a regular basis. So go out there, change your life, be kind to others, build people up, and stay safe in the shop. Thanks for watching, guys.